Hello. In this video, we are going to continue talking about scoring for brass instruments. We are going to talk especially about the combination of brass instruments with other orchestral sections. Let's remember the four major functions of the brass choir as a homophonic unit, alone or in combination with other orchestral choirs, as a presenter of melody, as a soloist in combination with other instruments, or as an independent voice in a contrapuntal texture, as a builder of orchestral climaxes, and finally, as a provider of coloristic effects, muted, jazzy, or more novel sounds and techniques. We are going to see and talk about some examples for each of these functions. In our previous lecture, we started talking about homophonic writing. A homophonic texture means that none of the instruments should become prominent. We want to hear all of the instruments at the same dynamic level and as a unity. The most important thing in a homophonic texture is the balance. The wind instruments in the orchestra should be divided into three parts, into three sections. The most dangerous part consists of the heavy brass instruments. You see here, heavy brass instruments, trumpets, trombones, and tuba. They have to be balanced in themselves. Therefore, it is highly recommended to start instrumenting with this section, with heavy brass instrument. And then the horns come in the second layer. After you balanced the heavy brass instruments, then you can add horns to the texture. And finally, woodwind instruments. This is the third layer, and so the weakest group of the wind instruments. This is an example from the late Romantic repertoire taken from the 7th Symphony by Anton Bruckner. This is a tutti passage, and the texture at the beginning is mostly monophonic. Although we have some deviations from this texture, the general characteristic is monophonic. At beginning with this measure, the texture becomes contrapuntal. We have an upwards movement and then a downwards movement, etc. Let's listen to it and we are going to talk about it. As you noticed, although all the instruments are playing here, the brass instruments strongly dominate. Let's take a closer look at the first page. In order to see it better, I divided the sections. We have here the woodwinds and then strings, and here the same passage, the same measures in brass instruments until that point. If you compare them, we will see that all the string instruments and woodwind instruments are playing in the same pitches, not in unison, at octaves, but the same pitches, the same melodic counter, and the same rhythm. If you compare them with brass instruments, we will see that they are almost the same. Let's take the horn, for example. F horn will sound a perfect fifth lower. By the way, about the instruments, F horn, perfect fifth lower. F trumpet, perfect fourth higher. And then we have here trombones as written. They will sound as written. And here a couple uncommon instruments, B flat, tenor, tuba. This one will sound a major ninth down, and this is F bass tuba. It will sound perfect 12th. That means an octave plus a perfect fifth down. And contrabass tuba as written. If you take the horn part, a sounding B, it is the same, and then a sounding F sharp. But you see the melodic contour is different. Instead of downwards movement, we have an upwards movement. And after that, we have a deviation here. This is a sounding E, but in the other sections, we have B. But after that, we hear D, which is also in the other sections. Then once again, a deviation, sounding C sharp instead of F sharp. But then they come once again together here. Another interesting deviation starts here. The horn sounds B, and weight the horn or the brass instruments in general wait until the other sections comes to the B again with the arpeggiation. They play only the last two notes, A sharp and B, and after that they are together. What about the trumpets and the trombones, alto and tenor trombones? They enter a little later on the last beat of the measure, but after that, at the entrance is also different from the horns. While the horns play a D, sounding D, they enter with F sharp. But after that, they are together with the horns. That means we have a unity here in the upper part of the brass section. If you take a look at the lower part, we see another unity. Let's take bass trombone part. It is almost the same. The other sections, they skip one note here, but after that they are once again together with this D. And in the next measure, they do the same as the other instruments. They wait until the string section and also the woodwind section arrive on B again. And they play A sharp and B. After that, they are together. Instead of letting all the instruments play the same thing, the same line, Bruckner introduces some small differences to the texture. In a fortissimo tutti texture, the most important thing is that all the instruments are playing in their ideal registers, as we see in this passage. Let's listen to it once again. Thank you. This is another tutti passage from the literature. Let's listen to it first. This is a very usual instrumentation, also today, two flutes, two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, one contrabassoon, four horns, three trumpets, three trombones and tuba, timpani. And you see in the timpani, by the way, the passage is in G minor. And in the timpani, we have G, D, that means tonic and dominant pitches, plus the subdominant pitch, C. And then the entire string section. Trumpets in F, that was common in the late Romantic music, but today we use mostly B-flat trumpets. And as I said, in the tutti passages, in the loud tutti passages, the most important thing is that all the instruments are playing in their optimal registers. If you take a look at the instruments, the flutes are playing in the highest register, which is the most effective register for the loud dynamic. And the oboes and clarinets are mostly doubled in unison, but one interesting usage is here, and also you see it here. Clarinet is higher than the oboe, because this would be too high for the oboe. So this is a very common technique to use clarinets higher than oboes in forte passages. We can find this texture exactly also in the string instruments. This is the bass line, also doubled by the second bassoon and contrabassoon. And we have in the first bassoon the viola part, one octave lower. So, and then the brass instruments. I'm sure you noticed it once again that the brass instruments dominates also in this example. There is nothing that can be done against it. In a tutti instrumentation, brass section will always dominate. A quick look at the doublings. In the third trombone and tuba, we have the bass line in octaves. The third trombone begins and then tuba enters here sometimes, but sometimes not. And the second trombone plays the line that is also played by the bassoon. And the first trombone's part can also be found in the clarinet, for example. E, E and G, we see here E, E and G. Between melody and the bass, we will have the harmonic voices. The important part, as I said, that all the instruments play in their optimal registers. Let's listen to it once again. And one more thing, as you see, in horns and trumpets, we don't use key signatures, also not in the timpani. The next example is one of the most famous instrumentations in the history. Mussorgsky's pictures at an exhibition was orchestrated by Maurice Ravel. This is the last movement of the work. Let's listen to the original score. And now, Ravel's orchestration. At the beginning, we had only the brass instruments with bassoons, and beginning with measure 13, we have also the other woodwind instruments. Let's compare the piano part. Here is the piano part with the Ravel's orchestration, the first four measures only. This is a choral-like texture, and in that kind of texture, the most important thing is the balance. Balance within the brass section and between brass section and other instruments. Let's take a look which instrument is playing which line. If you take a look at the trumpets, let's begin with the trumpets. By the way, we have C trumpets, they will sound as written. We have F horns as usual. Sound will be a perfect fifth lower, and also the other instruments will sound as written, except for contrabassoon, it will sound one octave lower. If you look at the trumpet part, we will see that they play the upper three lines, three voices in the piano part, and also here. This is the trumpet, and let's take a look at the horns. I take another color, blue maybe. It begins with B flat. This is an interesting thing. Ravel added a pitch to the texture which was not present in the original score, this B flat. We see this B flat also here in the trombone and also in the horns. B flat, and it is repeated. B is flat anyway. I didn't have to write it once again. B flat, and here again B flat, G, and B flat again. We will see B flat, G, E flat, and B flat. This is what horns play. And in the second measure, we see another addition, which is D. We see this also here in the tenor trombone. Once again, this is horn. And in the next measure, another addition, E flat. We have C. And here a D. The reason of these additions are to fill the gap, to avoid the gap in the orchestra. In piano, it wouldn't be a problem, but in the orchestra, it wouldn't be good if you don't hear anything in the alto tenor register, especially in such a texture, in a choral-like texture. Let's take a look at the trombones. I change the color. Let's take the green. We see in the tuba the bass line. It's entirely the bass line. And you also see that these grace notes are left out of the texture because it is impossible to realize them in the orchestra music. Beginning with the third trombone, G, B flat, notice the clef, B flat, and E flat. This is what trombones play. The middle three voices. In the next measure, beginning with B flat, this B flat major chord, and they keep play the same notes with the added tones. We have also this melodic motion in the first trombone and this one in the first trumpet, and here the B flat major chord. If you take a look at the bassoons, this is the bass line. Like tuba, we have a doubling between contrabassoon and tuba, and we have also the bass line in the first bassoon. In the first, we have this line, the doubling of the bass line. And this line, the roots, beginning with the root of the chord, E flat, D, B flat, G, and B flat again in the bassoon. You notice that we don't have some pitches in the lower register. We have bass, but we don't have this note, for example. Also not this one, this one, and this one. Instead of this, we have a gap in this register. On the other hand, we have some added notes in the middle register, in the alto tenor register. And this pitch, E flat, D, the pitches which are played by the second bassoon, they will be very weak. We won't even hear them. This is just a very tiny addition to the texture. In our course, we talked many times about the differences between piano scores and orchestral scores. And I mentioned that we have to make changes if we score a piano work for the orchestra. And this is a perfect example for this. If you fill this register in the orchestra, it will sound very muddy. In piano, it is not a problem. It sounds very well, but in the orchestra, we won't get the same sound. Sometimes we have to add some pitches which are not present in the score. Sometimes we have to leave some pitches out. We can also check the balance. Actually, it is not necessary to check it in every octave register. Let's take E flat, B flat, and G. Those are chord tones. E flat, how many instruments? We have one bassoon, 1 point, and one horn, 2 points, one trumpet and one trombone together, 8 points. I think that's all. Let's take a look at the B flat. We have one horn, two horns, 4 point together, and then one trumpet, one trombone, 8 point together, and that's all. We do not count the timpani. And G, two bassoons, 2 point, one horn, another 2 point, one trumpet, one trombone, and tuba, 12 points. Actually, it will not make especially much sense in such a texture because this G and this G is not the same. The function is different. This is a harmony tone, but this is the bass tone. But interestingly, we will find similar. This is 11, this is 12, and this is a little more, 16. They are close to each other, but as I said, we calculated this G and this G together. In such a texture, it will not give an exact guideline. The important part is we have all the chord tones in the trumpets, all the chord tones in the trombones, and also in the horns. If the heavy brass instruments are balanced in themselves, and if the horns and heavy brass instruments are balanced with each other, the result will be okay. And let's take a look at the passage where we have also the woodwind instruments. In the piano part, the octave register changes. We are not in the middle register anymore, we are in the high register. Let's check the balance. This is an A flat major chord in first inversion. We should be careful about one thing. I'm going to mention it very soon. We have C, which is bass, It is played by the tuba and by the second trombone, and also two bassoons and one bass clarinet are playing it. 4 + 4 + 3 = 11. And then we have E flat, but we have to, that was what I wanted to say, we have to differentiate in the first chord between two E flats. We have in the melody as a melodic line E flat, and then we have in the harmony, although it is not sustained in the first chord, we see that Ravel once again add this E flat here, and another one here, and he sustain it in the trombones. This is harmonic E flat, and it is played by two trombones and two horns. Two trombones, 8, and two horns for together 12. And then we have A flat. It is played by the second trumpet and two horns together 8. And also by three woodwind instruments together 11. And as I said, we have to make a differentiation between melody and harmony. This is E flat, melodic E flat. It is played by the trumpet and three woodwind instruments. So together, one trumpet, three woodwind instruments make 7. Actually, we see a slight imbalance that the actual melody has less power in relation to the other functions, which can have two reasons. First, because of the high register of the melody, we will perceive it louder than it actually is. And the second reason could be that Ravel didn't want to make this melody too penetrating. He wanted the melody to be a little in the background, a little coming from the distance. And I think the second one, the second reason, the later one, is more important than the first one in this case. Let's listen to the excerpt once again. Brass instruments are not melody instruments in their nature, but still, in the literature, there are wonderful passages in which brass instruments present the melody. In the melodic passages, brass instruments play mostly together. Individual brass instruments playing the melody are rare in the literature. Let's have a listen to this excerpt in which all the brass instruments are playing the same melodic line. The excerpt was taken from Hindemith, by the way, and this sound is very characteristic, especially in the late Romantic music and in the first half of the 20th century, this characteristic brass choir sound. The next example is by Strauss, taken from Don Quixote, symphonic poem. I don't want to analyze everything. I just want to indicate that B flat tenor tuba, bass tuba, D trumpets, and bassoons, and here also second violin and viola are playing the same line in octaves. Let's listen to it. And in this colorful passage, we see a doubling between two trumpets and two oboes. Notice the register of the oboe. This is the most optimal register for the fortissimo dynamic. Let's listen to it. This excerpt is taken from the Fifth Symphony by Prokofiev. The only thing is that tuba doubles the bass line, which is played by violoncello and the double bass, and adds brass color to the texture. Let's listen to it. This is an example taken from the opera Siegfried by Wagner. It's an example of the usage of different articulations at the same time. We see a melodic line in the B-flat bass tuba. And we have the same line also in the woodwinds, in the bass clarinet and bassoons, with different articulations. The line is legato in woodwinds and non legato in the tuba. Let's listen to it. In this excerpt taken from the opera Rosamunde by Schubert, we are going to hear a melody, a beautiful melody in the strings, and harmony in the wind instruments. And beginning with measure 115, we have a monophonic texture. All the instruments are playing the same melodic line, and we see a mechanical decrescendo. We call this process mechanical decrescendo. At the beginning, all the instruments are playing the same line, and here the first trombone stops playing, and then flutes, and then the second trombone, then the other woodwind instruments, after that, short after that, strings, and only the third trombone and lower string instruments continue playing the line until the end. We call this process mechanical decrescendo. Let's listen to it. Thank you. In the next example taken from Le Prelude by Liszt, we are going to hear the melody by trombones and tuba, doubled by bassoons and by the violoncello and double bass. Let's listen to it. This is an example of a brilliant marsh-like brass sound. It is taken from 1812 overture by Tchaikovsky, and it is about a war. It is about a glory. So Tchaikovsky uses cornets and trumpets doubled with the wind instruments. On the other side, we have a bass melody played by the horns and trombones and tuba doubled with the strings and bassoon. And you see here, this is an additional band to be played by extra available brass instruments. Let's listen to it. And finally, an example by Wagner. We have a choral-like passage played by the brass instruments, by the trumpets and trombones, and it is always doubled. And as you see in also in our previous examples, brass instruments are mostly doubled by other sections, not in order to make them more powerful. Exactly the opposite, to make them a little less brilliant. I explained in our previous lectures, if two instruments play the same line, then their harmonics collided from time to time and the resulting sound will be less brilliant. And here it is doubled by the string instruments, and after that string instruments stop playing and they are doubled by the woodwind instruments. Let's listen to it. You see, despite all the doublings, they still dominate the resulting sound. If you want to use the brass section in a contrapuntal texture, we will have approximately the same problem which we have in the string section. Because of the homogeneity of the instruments, brass instruments are not especially ideal for contrapuntal textures within the section. They are not as homogeneous as the string instruments, but they are also not as heterogeneous as the woodwind instruments. Before we talk about some examples from the literature, I'd like to mention the six basic elements of instrumentation. In addition to compositional elements, we have instrument or combination of instruments. We have instrumental register, orchestral register, dynamics, articulation, and method of sound production. Why are those elements important for us? In order to create contrast. This contrast could be within one section between different lines. In a contrapuntal texture, it will be extremely important creating contrast between lines to make them more individual. Or this contrast could be between formal sections. The first one is instrument or combination of instruments. In one formal section, we can use a particular instrumentation, let's say woodwinds and strings. And in another formal section, we can use only brass. Or likewise, if it is within one formal section, we can use woodwind instruments, let's say flute, and then brass instrument, string, etc. Instrumental register and orchestral register are not the same thing. Instrumental register means, imagine, let's say this is our grand staff with F clef. Bass register, tenor register, alto register, soprano register, etc. Those are orchestral register. And then we have instrumental registers within only one instrument. Let's say the clarinet. Clarinet, this register is different than this register in the clarinet. Change of instrumental register if you use only one instrument, or change of orchestral register are very effective techniques in creating contrast. So then we have dynamics, articulation. I think they are clear. We have many dynamics, from a very quiet dynamic to a very loud dynamic. And articulation, staccato, marcato, tenuto, legato, etc. And method of sound production is playing technique. For example, pizzicato, sul poncello, or in brass instruments using a mute. For example, harmon mute. So, those six elements are very important in the orchestration, in the instrumentation in general, but they are extremely important in the contrapuntal writing. This is a brilliant example of contrapuntal writing taken from Roman Carnival Overture by Berlioz. Let's listen to it and then we are going to talk about it. As you probably noticed, this is a canonic texture We have multiple entries. The first one is made by bassoons, two bassoons at the same time. And then we have also some secondary melodic figurations. And the second entry made by brass instruments, three trombones. This is oddo actually, forgetting in the score. By three trombones and tuba. We are going to see one more example of this usage in piano dynamic. The more instruments, the softer is the sound. It doesn't work as we expect. Actually, we expect the more instrument, the stronger should be the sound. But in the practice, because of the harmonics of the instruments blur the sound of each other. And the resulting sound will be less penetrating in piano dynamic. In forte dynamic, it is another story. And we have another entry here and some further entries. And as you see, using different instruments is main element of contrast. First, bassoon, a woodwind instrument, and then the secondary line, the secondary melodic figuration comes from violin, a completely different instrument. And then we have brass color. With brass, we have oboe and flute color. Different kinds of instruments make it possible to perceive melodic lines individually. And this is very important in orchestration. Let's listen to the excerpt once again. This example is by Stravinsky. The work is Johann Sebastian Bach choral variations on Vom Himmel Hoch. And this is Stravinsky's instrumentation and this is the original score. And it is optional to play it with the organ at the same time, simultaneously. Let's listen to it and then we are going to talk about it. The dominating color in this excerpt is the one of the brass instruments as opposed to the previous example. In this example, we don't have the contrasting element of using different instruments. So, let's take a look how Stravinsky resolved this problem. First of all, we have two individual lines in the trumpets. And both of them are the same instrument, C trumpet, and the lines are very similar. If you look carefully, we will see that the contrast is provided by the instrumental register. The first trumpet is playing in the relatively higher register, and the second trumpet is playing in a relatively lower register, and the articulation. While the first trumpet plays staccato, the second trumpet plays tenuto. And also here a staccato upwards motion, and here we have a legato with trill. And we see the same situation also here, this time vice versa. In the first trumpet we have a legato texture, in the second one a staccato, and after that tenuto. A different articulation than the one of the first trumpet. Although we have also a orchestral registral difference between two instruments, this is tenor trombone and this is trumpet. This is much lower than the trumpet. Stravinsky continues using different articulation for the lines. Here we don't have much difference except for the first one, a tenuto, but after that, beginning with the third one, we have a legato texture in the trumpet and a tenuto, a non-legato line in the trombone. And here, staccato against tenuto, staccato against tenuto, etc. So the contrasting elements are instrumental registers, orchestral registers, beginning with also in this case in the bass trombone, orchestral register, and also here, and articulation. All the other elements are the same, the instruments are the same, the dynamic is the same, and the method of sound production is also the same. All the instruments are playing without mute. Let's listen to the excerpt once again. In this example, taken from Symphonic Metamorphoses by Hindemith, we have only the brass instruments in a contrapuntal texture. We have an entry here and then another one here, and if you look further, a further one here, etc. The instruments are similar, although we have some differences in timbre between horns and trombones. The general characteristic is the same. Hindemith uses two things to create contrast: dynamic and articulation. We have different dynamics in the instruments and also different articulations here, mezzo forte, non-legato with some accents, and here staccato. On the next page, when the trumpet enters, then horn becomes piano and the articulation becomes staccato, and here we have some accented notes, etc. Let's listen to the excerpt. In this example, we are going to talk about two things. First, the melody, which is played by three trombones together in unison in pianissimo dynamic, and the instrumentation of the accompaniment figure. Let's listen to it, and then we are going to talk about it. As I said, if three trombones play together in a soft dynamic, the resulting sound is less brilliant. And about the instrumentation of the accompaniment line, we see here some parts which complement each other. The first violin and double bass. The second violin and viola. And there's also a dialogue between violoncello and these instruments. And this line is also supported by the flute and oboes. Many complementary lines, and if they come together, there's a very nice, very colorful and static accompaniment texture. This is one of the first examples of this kind. This kind of instrumentation, that is, giving a motion into a static texture, became very favored in the Impressionist music and later on in the second half of the 20th century by the avant-garde composers. By the way, one more thing. You see here the double bass is playing alone without any doubling. But the general rule was that they shouldn't play alone. They should always be doubled by another instrument at unison or at octave. There are two exceptions to this rule. First, in piano dynamic or softer, and second, if they play pizzicato. Here, the dynamic is pianissimo, and it is also forgotten, but the passage is in pizzicato. They play pizzicato. Therefore, it is acceptable. Let's listen to it once again. Before we conclude our lecture, I'd like to give one example of their coloristic usage. The wah-wah effect with wah-wah or harmon mood. Harmon and wah-wah mood is the same actually. I'm going to explain this mood because it is especially favored in this usage. It was initially employed in jazz, and it began to be used in a great deal of American orchestral music throughout the latter part of the 20th century. So here is an example taken from Rhapsody in Blue by George Gershwin. Let's listen to it. The excerpt begins with soprano saxophone and then continues with trumpet and after that trombone. And you see here with jazz mood. The notation was for that time, for Gershwin times, okay, because it was completely new. But today we have to be more precise about the usage of the harmon mute. The wah-wah mute and the harmon mute are the same mute. A wah-wah mute is the harmon mute with stem in. If we take the stem out, then we have a harmon mute. If we use wah-wah mute, by the way, we call it wah-wah mute, not jazz mute today. we have to be precise about its notation. That means open, and that means close. Here, it is left to the player how to play it open and close, because, as I said, the notation, it was not notated, it was only practiced in the jazz music, and Gershwin was, as far as I know, the first one who notated it, who used it in a classical composition. But today we have to be precise about the usage of vowel mode, open and close. Stockhausen also graded it by many levels, between completely closed and completely open. He requested also the other steps between them. So, let's listen to it once again. That's all for this lecture. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next lecture.